public defender is an attorney employed by the community and responsible for giving legal aid without cost to any person who seeks it and is financially unable to employ private counsel. It is his duty to defend those accused of crime until the issue is decided in a court of law. The first public defender's office in the United States was opened in January 1913. Over the years, other offices were opened. And today, that handful has grown to a network. A network of lawyers cooperating to protect the rights of our clients. The defendant, Joseph McDonald, age 16. The charges, arson and manslaughter. The place, El Clemente, California, a town gripped by fury.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Carl Smith speaking to you from the corridor of Superior Court, Citrus County, California. For the past few weeks, this town of 23,000 has been boiling with a violent hate. Inside the courtroom right now, the prosecution is presenting its case against one Joe McDonald. Unfortunately, Judge Lamar has cleared the court of spectators and press, but we do have a way of finding out what's going on in there. Oh, excuse me. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. George Berry, owner of the burned hotel, has just finished testifying. Mr. Berry, the angry man of El Clemente, has almost single-handed whipped this town into the frenzy which grips it now. Oh, excuse me. Excuse me, please. May I see you for just a moment, please, sir? Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mr. George Berry. Mr. Berry, we understand you've just finished testifying.
Yeah. I told him the truth about that firebug. He'll get what's coming to him. Judge Lamar was the one who decided he was to be tried instead of being turned over to the youth authority.
Well, could you tell us what you said on the witness stand?
The truth. The district attorney called me and I told him that...
Mr. Berry, did the defendant have any personal motive for setting fire to your hotel?
He hated me.
Why?
Last year, I saw him hitchhiking a ride on Highway 101. When he got in the car, I saw his sweatshirts had the letters SMO on it.
And what did those initials mean to you?
St. Michael's Orphanage. I figured he was running away. So I zigzagged around some back roads, and before the kid knew what was happening, I had him back inside the gates.
Did he say anything to you that night?
When the sister was taking him in, he yelled, "I know you. You own that hotel. I'll get even with you."
Mr. Berry, is the public defender putting up much of a fight?
How can he? That boy signed a confession. How can Matthews get out of that?
Well, at his press conference, he said he was going to call but two witnesses, the boy and his sister, Anthony.
Sister Anthony?
That's what he said.
We'll see about that.
Sister Anthony? Well, I taught the boys how to fish and got enough dinner for a whole table.
Sister Anthony, there's a visitor.
You should come with us next time. When the good Lord has a trout hook onto your line, there's a satisfaction. Oh, thank you.
You have a visitor, Mr. Barry.
Oh, my. Sister, you please take this to the kitchen.
He seems very angry.
Well, we'll just push up our backs and go see him.
Now listen, Sister Anthony, I came here to tell you...
Barry, won't you try one of our nice chairs?
I had poor boxes in every room of my hotel, and every nickel went to this orphanage. I never missed a year giving...
And may the good Lord have you continue to favor us.
How? I've got no hotel, no business, no nothing. Thanks to you and the way you treat these kids when they go wrong. Instead of manslaughter, they should be trying Joe McDonald for murder. He's a killer, I tell you, a born killer.
So help me God.
Joey, you heard the first witness.
Your Honor?
Does the district attorney have an objection?
I object to the public defender violating legal decorum by making a cheap appeal for the court's sympathy by addressing his client as Joey.
Denied. Proceed, Mr. Matthews.
Now, Joey, let me read this to you. I, Joe McDonald, confess that I bought 3 gallons of gasoline at Porter's Garage and used it to set fire to the Citrus Hotel. Is that your signature?
Yes, sir.
Is this confession true?
No, sir.
Your Honor, object. The defendant has admitted that the signature is genuine. No violence or force was used to obtain this confession, nor was any promise of immunity given. The prosecution holds that since the confession is genuine, defendant be enjoined from denying its validity.
Denied. Proceed, Mr. Matthews.
If this confession was untrue, why did you sign it?
Well, it was almost 4 o'clock in the morning. They kept asking me the same questions over and over again. I could hardly stay awake.
Did you know what you were signing?
Well, I just wanted to sleep, to stop all those questions. So I signed.
But it is true that you bought the gasoline.
Yes, sir.
Where did you get the money?
Well, you see, it was like this. I went to Sister Anthony's office.
Afternoon, Joey.
Hi, Sister Anthony.
Sit down.
Thank you.
You'll enjoy this. It's called The Two Little Nuns.
Well, I haven't time.
Did you lose your privilege time?
No. No, Sister, I... Well, I need some new shoes.
And you'd like some money to go into town for new shoes?
Yes, Sister.
They're running at Hollywood Park.
Are they?
I found this under a boy's locker.
You never said not to read it.
There's a circle around the name of a trainer at Hollywood Park. Tom Van Buren. Haven't I heard you speak about him?
Mm-hmm. He was a friend of my father's.
Joey, you're planning to run away again. Finish your vocational training here. Learn to be a mechanic. Then, if you want to become a jockey, you know I'd rather you became a good jockey than a bad mechanic. But can't it wait?
When I went into town with the truck, I saw Mr. Van Buren. He's living at the hotel.
Did he offer you a job?
Mr. Van Buren is on the Oregon Short Line.
Is that a railroad?
No, he's broke. But he's got two mares with early foot. And if he can get to Caliente, he can win a purse.
Why doesn't he?
He can't even promote gasoline money. But if I could pay for the gas, I can ride at Caliente on Saturday. Oh, please, Sister Anthony.
Absolutely no. We haven't enough money now without financing horse trainers.
Okay, Sister Anthony.
There's a truck going into town at 5:30. It'll drop you at the shoe store.
Thank you, Sister Anthony. Thank you. Before I left the orphanage, I went to the kitchen and got an empty 5-gallon can. In town, I got some gas and went to the hotel. I was looking for Mr. Van Buren's room on the second floor when it happened. In for Mr. Van Buren, they wouldn't let me.
Let me go! You gotta let me go! Mr. Van Buren's still in there! Hey, look. Everything I have in the world. Look at it. My whole life. Look at it burn. Look at it burn.
I stayed there until they carried Mr. Van Buren out.
And then what happened?
I ran away. I had to.
Why?
A man from the paper took my picture after I carried the old lady out. He knew I was from the orphanage, and I was afraid they might take me back.
Well, where did you go?
I hitched a ride to San Ysidro.
The town just this side of the Mexican border?
A lot of people from Caliente go there. That's where I found a man that used to know my father.
And did you get a job riding?
Yes, sir. I had the leg up on competitive in the fifth, and...
Don't these people have anything else to do?
It's their recreation, like us watching TV.
What's the name of Joey's horse?
Competitive.
Attention, the horses are nearing the starting gate.
80-1. If we bet a dollar and Joey won, we'd get back $81.
Sister Anne.
Imagine how many new blankets $81 would buy. Wouldn't it be wonderful if Competitive did win? His horse had no closing look at all. Come on, we'll wait at the jockey's room. Hello, Joey.
Sister Anne, you can't come to a racetrack.
We received permission from the Bishop of the Diocese to come. And, Joey, come back. I failed, Sister Marie.
He was frightened.
Is that what I teach our boys, to be afraid of me?
If we hurry that next
bus, we'll wait, sister.
You're not taking me back.
Joey, please come out. You don't have to run away from us.
I was in San Diego. I saw the paper from home. They're looking for me. They say I started the fire.
Did you, Joey?
No. No, sister. On my word to God. But Mr. Barry and everybody, they want to put me in jail.
They can't if you're innocent.
But they will. They're calling me a killer. They hate me. They all hate me.
Lord have mercy on their souls. They're not evil. Not even Mr. Barry. He had no insurance on the hotel. At his age, to be alone, penniless, it's done something to him.
Even you're on his side.
You're not safe here. Those people are an angry mob. They'll come after you.
They'll never find me.
They won't stop till they do. Come back now with us. We've already talked to the public defender. He'll help you.
No. No, he can't help me.
Why not?
Nobody can help me except... except the old woman. The one I carried out of the hotel. She knows I didn't start that fire. But she's not going to get better. It said so in the paper.
She will get better. We're saying special prayers for her.
But, sister, the paper said that she wasn't going...
In our 6 years together, you taught me about horses. Didn't I at least teach you to have faith?
That bus leaves in a few minutes.
There'll be another after Joey's next race. Please come back with us.
right, sister. We'll go see that public defender. And that's the truth, Mr. Matthews.
If only that woman you saved would come out of her coma.
Oh. Come on. You're going where you belong, to jail.
Now, just a minute.
He's wanted by the police.
Let them come and get him.
I'm making a citizen's arrest.
No, you're not.
Who's stopping me?
I am. As a lawyer, I'm an officer of the court. This boy's in my custody.
All right, I'll get a cop.
And you call yourself a Christian? Think, Mr. Barry. Think of the terrible thing you've done to this whole city.
I didn't burn anybody to death.
Neither did I.
He's a good boy. I raised him. I know he's a good boy.
To you, all boys are good. Well, just read the daily paper, sister. These boys, 15, 16, 17, they're on the front pages every day. They drive hot rods 80 miles an hour. They stick up stores. They lie. They cheat. They kill. And people like you keep saying, go easy on them. They're boys. Well, it's time we set an example.
But he can prove he didn't start the fire.
How?
That woman he carried out, she'll tell you.
In the next world, she just died.
Public indignation is running high, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, just a minute. I've just had a signal that Public Defender Matthews is about to conclude his direct examination.
Well, that's all I know, Mr. Matthews.
Thank you, Joey. If it pleases the court, at this time I would like to move for a directed verdict of acquittal on the grounds that the prosecution has not proved a case against the defendant.
Motion denied. Cross-examine. When did you go to St. Michael's Orphanage?
6.5 years ago.
Why?
Because my parents... Because there was nobody to take care of me.
How did your parents die?
In a fire.
A fire of mysterious origin?
Objection.
Sustained. Defendant's not qualified to answer.
But, Your Honor, I'm prepared to show that no natural cause was ever found for the fire in which the defendant's parents died. And further, that the defendant was called a hero in the newspaper report at that time, just as he was after this fire.
Objection sustained. Court stands in recess until 10 a.m. tomorrow.
Recess till 10 o'clock tomorrow. You better get back. They'll be coming out.
Matthews. Now, listen. You're supposed to be the public defender. Well, we're the public, and we don't want Joey McDonald defended.
Everyone is entitled to be defended.
Who says so?
The Constitution, Amendment Number 6.
Mr. Berry, you have done a terrible thing.
Me?
You've taught the people to hate. Because of you, this city is filled with poison. If you have no regard for the Sixth Amendment, at least respect the Lord your God and go pray that he forgives you for disobeying his teaching of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. How goes it inside?
Not so good, I'm afraid.
You mustn't lose faith.
If only we could find that can that Joey used for the gasoline.
Are you sure it's not still at the hotel?
I went over every inch of the place.
Your little firebug isn't denying now he bought the gasoline, is he?
No, Mr. Berry, but if Joey did drop that can of gasoline with a cap on it, the fire would have exploded it.
So?
So that can of gasoline could help prove that Joey McDonald is telling the truth.
He's not. He's lying. He's a dirty little liar. He said he'd get even with me, and he did. Now it's my turn.
Mr. Berry, do you know where that can is?
Why don't you go back to the orphanage? Stay where you belong.
This is where I belong, Mr. Berry. Close to that boy.
Why don't you help somebody who deserves it?
The Lord loves everyone alike. Mr. Berry, you wandered through that burned-out hotel for days after the fire. Did you find that can?
If I did, why would I hide it?
Because you were afraid.
Afraid? Of who?
Of the people. The minute you heard that Joey signed that confession, you started your rabble-rousing against the boy. You lit a flame of hatred that went through this city like wildfire. After all your speeches, if you did find that can, you'd have to admit to the whole city that you were wrong. You couldn't do that, could you? Is that what happened? Is it?
I do for you.
Mr. Matthews said that all you told about in court was fighting the fire and getting Joey McDonald's confession.
I didn't know until this afternoon he would deny the confession.
You told Mr. Matthews that you never went back to the hotel.
Sister, I know how much this boy means to you, but we're busy here. When we get a confession, we haven't got time to check to see if the person's telling us the truth. If somebody admits to setting a fire, we take his word for it.
If you went back to the hotel, would there still be anything there that might help the boy?
I don't know. Sister Anthony, look at this desk. I spend 12 hours a day in this chair, and when I... Pardon me. Chief Cooper speaking. That's right. What? Who is this? Hello? Hello? The gasoline can just showed up.
Where? Who found it? Who was that?
I don't know, but he said it was behind the incinerator in back of the hotel.
I got it.
Here we are.
Back at Superior Court again, ladies and gentlemen. We've just received word that Fire Chief Cooper has been recalled to the stand, this time as a witness for the defense. Public Defender Matthew seems to think that the testimony of Fire Chief Cooper will be the turning point in this case. Of course, he's refused to divulge what that testimony will be, but I can tell you this. The chief was seen entering the courtroom a few minutes ago carrying a badly burned 5-gallon can.
And when the gasoline was heated, it created enough pressure to explode the can at the seams.
Then the cap must have been on during the fire.
It sure was. I couldn't get it off with a pair of pliers.
Did you examine the interior of the hotel?
Yes.
Would you tell the court what you found?
That the fire started on the second floor.
Well, how do you know that?
Well, the floor of the last room on the left-hand side was burned as badly as the walls and ceiling.
What does that mean?
Well, that was the room of origin. A fire burns downward. In every other room and in the corridor, we could tell from the wood that the fire had burned the ceiling first.
So the fire started in a room and spread until it reached the gasoline and exploded.
That's right. The fire was caused by an overturned electric heater. The gasoline just helped after the fire had a good start.
Ladies and gentlemen, the trial of the people versus Joe McDonald is over. Judge Lamar has dismissed all charges against the young jockey. Let me repeat that. Judge Lamar has dismissed all charges against young Joe McDonald. But before we return to the studio, two final notes. The first, to all those students of mob psychology. When Public Defender Matthews and young McDonald left the courtroom a few minutes ago, the crowd cheered. Final note, Young Joe McDonald has been signed as contract rider for Jerry Devine's public stable and will ride this Saturday at Agua Caliente.
The next race, the St. Michael's Orphanage Purse at a mile and a 16th.
And if I win, my whole 10% will go to St. Michael's Orphanage.
Bless you, my boy.
Good luck, Joey.
Thank you.
And Joey, this horse is a closer. Stay off the pace to the head of the stretch. Then make your move.
Yes, Sister Anthony.
Tonight's case was brought to a fair and just conclusion through the efforts of a public defender and of a lady of our Lord who never lost faith and never forgot that faith can work miracles. Tonight, Revlon salutes Jess G. Sutlett, public defender of Inyo County, Independence, California, the 74th and most recently appointed public defender for outstanding achievement in the cause of justice. Public defender is an attorney employed by the community and responsible for giving legal aid without cost to any person who seeks it and is financially unable to employ private counsel. It is his duty to defend those accused of crime until the issue is decided in a court of law. The first public defender's office in the United States was opened in January 1913. Over the years, other offices were opened. And today, that handful has grown to a network. A network of lawyers cooperating to protect the rights of our clients. In this area, you will find hotels, theaters, large department stores, and smaller merchants.
Not $10, not $5, but $2. Two, I lose a buck on every one I sell, so buy me out and break me. What do you expect to reduce the Hope Diamond? Now, come on, ladies. It costs $2 to get married, but look. How about you, ladies? Good. Another satisfied customer. Good for you. Now, who else wants a bargain to take home and... Uh-oh. Shop's closed. Excuse me, ladies. Excuse me. Does the Wilshire bus stop here?
Okay, wise guy. Move along.
Yes.
Hey, wait a minute.
I'm leaving. What do you want, blood?
Your name's Kilgore, isn't it?
Yeah, that's me, the sidewalk Tiffany, but no autograph today, pal.
I got an invitation for you.
Well, I don't go for blind dates, pal.
These are old friends. They want you at the West L.A. station.
For what?
Laughs. They haven't booked a comedian all day.
The whole place needs paint. A couple of pictures up here. Maybe even a jukebox over in the corner. Oh, Mr. Matthews.
Oh, hi, Kilgore.
Well, one thing about me, I'm loyal. You can handle me again.
What have they got you in for this time?
These jokers think that I broke into a residence.
And you're innocent.
Oh, Natch.
Got an alibi?
Oh, it's a beauty. Now, let me play it for you.
I haven't been assigned to your case yet.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Well, I'll see you tomorrow. That is, unless they get smart and spring me out of here tonight. Oh, he's a sweetheart, that Matthews. You know what? Handle me three times. Three convictions. Hey, listen, buddy. You want to buy a hunk of nice jewelry for your girl? No. No girl would be that desperate.
The following day, Kilgore was arraigned, and my office was assigned to defend him. The charge was breaking and entering, and theft of a diamond brooch, a star sapphire ring, and a pair of pigskin gloves.
This one'll be a ball for you.
You don't seem very worried.
I'll let the DA worry.
If you're convicted again, you could get 10 to 20.
Counselor, I thought you knew me. I couldn't have pulled this caper.
It followed your exact pattern. That's why they picked you up.
I've been picked up for everything except Barman Pearl Harbor. Now, do you want me to show you why I couldn't have pulled this one? So let's look at it from the pro angle.
All right.
This fella Mitchell gets a phony call that his daughter is in the hospital from an accident.
You always telephoned the victim and got him out of the house.
Oh, yeah, but with class. I mean, I called on Maid's Night Out, see? This guy calls on a Tuesday night, goes up through a second-story window. How does he know he ain't going into the maid's room?
Well, go on.
Now, look. I always called and told him the office was on fire. See, it's tougher to check. It's those touches, see, Counselor. I mean, that's what makes the difference between an amateur and a pro.
Yeah, but look, Kilgore, the...
No, no. Besides, if I did this job, where's the loot?
The victim identified the gloves you were wearing. He said they were stolen from his dresser.
Would I heist a second-hand pair of gloves?
Well, where did you get them?
Oh, I got them in Memphis.
When?
6-8 months ago.
What store?
Counselor, it looks to me like you don't believe me. Would I lie to you?
You always have.
Well, no, that's no way to talk to a client.
Now, you've had an airtight alibi every time I've defended you, and the district attorney has blasted your story wide open in each case.
I thought I had him last time.
It might help if you tell me the truth.
Counselor, if I'm not telling the truth, may I never eat dinner at the White House?
I'm not the one who'll go to San Quentin.
Look, I'm leveling. See, I walk by this little joint in Memphis. I see these gloves, 10 clams. I got a buck in my kick. Gotta have the gloves. So I walk in, I make a deal with the guy. Give him the buck, and he holds the gloves till I come up with the rest.
Now, what street was this store on?
Oh, G
Jackson, near a hotel.
Now, you said that you had an airtight alibi.
Well, oh, I have.
Now, this crime was committed last Tuesday night somewhere between 9:30 and 11 o'clock. Where were you?
Oh, well, Saturday night Hazel, Friday night Julia, Thursday night Eloise, Wednesday night, I played poker Wednesday, Tuesday night, oh, yeah, Annie Pie.
Does this Annie Pie have a last name?
Hobart, Ann Hobart. She lives at 111 North Parkway.
Now, that's a nice address.
Yeah, she's a nice doll. You ought to see her.
I intend to.
You'll enjoy yourself. She's a million laughs. Now, breakdown, counselor. Did you ever have a more lovable client?
I spent the rest of that morning with Deputy Public Defender Martha Hamilton, preparing the defense of Allie Kilgore.
Stop. A stamped inside right glove is trademark of Keystone Glove Company. Stop. Would appreciate your cooperation in locating store and securing deposition from clerk. Signed, etc., etc. You know, I'm developing a taste for lukewarm coffee.
We've all been eating drugstore lunches and dinners at our desks, and I wouldn't mind if we were spending time on those homicide cases, but...
Kilgore's case is important, too.
To Kilgore?
To all of us. Now, we handle 1,000 cases a month, and they're all important.
Don't you ever get sick and tired of the alley Kilgores?
On the average of 2 or 3 times a day.
Then why?
You know, I wish all of our clients were nicely tailored, freshly manicured, cultured, wholesome, well-adjusted adults, but they're not. Now, we get the homeless, the penniless, neurotic. And when you're swamped with work, they become just cases. Legal checkers to be moved about a board. But they're not cases or checkers. They're people. End of lecture. End of sandwich.
Thanks.
For what?
For putting me back on my white horse.
Between a request from the San Francisco Public Defender's Office, defending 3 clients in court, and preparing to argue an appeal, I didn't get much time to think about Allie Kilgore. Until I saw him 2 days later at his preliminary hearing.
Look, Mr. Matthews, you got to spring me.
I'll try.
Well, I tell you, I'm going into business. You got a great idea. Customers all over the world. A do-it-yourself jailbreak kit.
Now, look, Allie, I don't know whether you realize how serious this is,
Are you Allie Kilgore?
I cannot tell a lie. Must be one of my fans.
I'm Alan Elwood Logan, Deputy District Attorney. I've been assigned to prosecute you.
Bully for you.
Now, Kilgore, I've only got a minute, but...
This is my barrister, Mr. Matthews, the public defender.
I'd like to save the trouble and expense of a trial. If you'll plead him to petty theft, I think...
He's an eager one.
I've cleaned up 3 other cases this morning, and...
And if he remains untied and undefeated, he goes to the Rose Bowl.
Matthews, I don't have much time.
Look, pal, I can't cop a plea. You ever served time at San Quentin? Oh, no, of course not. See, I got a reputation to uphold. Now, a guy at San Quentin cops a plea, he's got to hang out with the petty larceny bums. But a fella pleads not guilty and gets convicted, he gets to mix with a higher class group. And I don't need to tell you that a man is known by the company he keeps.
I'll see you again.
Well, don't bother to call. Just drop right in. Oh, to be young and beautiful again.
Well, let's get back to business. Did you think of anything that might help your case?
Well, I almost remember the name of that store. You know where I got the gloves?
You almost remember it.
Yes, sir. Look, it's a guy's first name, Mr. Matthews, like Joe's Men's Store or Willie's Men's Store or something. There's a big red sign in front of the joint.
Well, I haven't heard yet from the Memphis public defender. This might help him.
Mm. Hey, Mr. Matthews, how'd you like Annie Pie?
Well, I didn't see her yet. I'm going over right after we finish here.
Ann Hobart lived in the Griffith Park area on a small street up in the hills. Seeing the right name on the mailbox at the right address made me feel my hunch was right. Kilgore was finally telling the truth.
Yes, Mr. Matthews.
My office is representing a friend of yours.
Really?
Yes, he was accused of a crime, and he says that he was with...
Hey, you're right, Pitsy. You say a friend of mine has been arrested?
Yes, and if you'll make yourself available to testify...
Well, who is this friend?
I'm sorry. Allie Kilgore.
Yes, Pitsy. We're going inside in a minute. Kilgore. I've never heard of anyone named Allie Kilgore.
Thank you very much.
I have that deposition from the witness in Santa Monica.
Oh, yes, that's for the Providence PD office, isn't it?
Yes, he corroborated their witness's story.
Well, it's nice to know that someone's story was corroborated.
Oh, sounds like a bad case of Kilgore poisoning.
Now, don't gloat.
Sorry. What happened?
Well, Kilgore's alibi said she didn't know him.
What did Memphis say?
I don't know. I haven't heard yet.
But I thought... Well, I was almost sure I heard Miss Jenkins taking a telegram on the phone, and I thought it was from there.
Well, let me check. Yes, here it is. Regarding your telegram January 10th, sorry for delay, had to check every haberdashery wholesaler and distributor in this area. All report no Keystone gloves ever sold in the state of Tennessee. Well, maybe Mr. Kilgore can explain this.
To some business in Department 91 of the Superior Court. I went upstairs to the visiting room to see Allie Kilgore.
Hey, this is Counselor. I rustled up another client for you. Now, it seems this fella was...
Kilgore, are you physically incapable of telling the truth?
Hey, what are you steamed about?
Well, Anna Hobart said that she never heard of you.
What? Oh, come on, Doc. Play it in E-flat.
Now, who do you think the jury will believe, you or her?
Well, I guess that's no contest. Wait a minute. I can prove she's lying.
How?
Go in the property room and get my wallet. There's a picture of us together.
The Memphis public defender can't find that store.
What?
And on top of that, those gloves were made by the Keystone Glove Company in Detroit, Michigan. And they don't sell Keystone gloves in Memphis, Tennessee. Is that good enough for you?
Memphis? I never said Memphis. Everybody knows Jackson Street's in Chicago.
Now look, Kilgore. No public defender's office has time to play games.
It was Jackson Street. The name of the joint was a guy's first moniker. And I did put a buck down.
All right.
Look, Mr. Matthews, I know I'm no bargain. I'm a liar, three-time loser, and a wise guy. But I don't con you. But I'm not asking for any sympathy. I don't want any. This is a bum rap. I was never near this guy Mitchell's house.
Either you're the world's greatest salesman or I'm the world's biggest chump.
Why?
Because I believe you. I then went down to room 606 in the Hall of Justice, where I had a date to meet Paul Mitchell, the victim of the burglary.
Surprised to see me?
Frankly, yes. I was expecting to see Mr. Mitchell.
Please lay off our witnesses.
The witnesses don't belong to either side.
What do you want him for?
I'd like him to examine the gloves again and see if he still thinks they're his.
Well, of course he does.
Do you mind if he decides that?
No, but this is a terrible waste of my time and the taxpayers' money.
Good morning. Sorry I'm late.
Oh, good morning. Could I have the evidence in the...
I've already gotten it.
Mr. Mitchell, would you examine these carefully?
Of course. See these burns, Mr. Matthews?
Yes.
Well, one night I forgot about a cigarette until I felt the heat through my glove.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mitchell.
Need any more?
Kilgore smokes, too.
I admire your perseverance, but why?
But why what?
We both have a lot of other things to do. Why waste time on somebody with three convictions?
He's not being tried for those crimes.
I know that.
He says he's innocent of this one.
He says. Who is Allie Kilgore to say anything to tie us up this way?
A man with certain rights. The Constitution calls them inalienable rights.
But Mr. Matthews, if this man broke into my house...
If he did, his rights won't protect him. They only guarantee him a fair trial. I'll thank you for coming in, Mr. Mitchell.
Not at all.
Leaving the Hall of Justice, I went to room 235 and got Kilgore's wallet.
What I found was a pleasant surprise. I signed a receipt for the picture and took it with me. Ann Hobart had been lying. But why?
Now, Miss Jenkins, will you please try Ann Hobart again in an hour?
Your Chicago call come through yet?
Oh, not yet. And would you check on that call to the Chicago PD office? Do you have something for them?
The call, the Angola case.
Yeah, did we ever locate his brother?
The Indianapolis PD office just missed him. But he's due in Chicago today. They don't know which hotel he'll stay at, though.
Oh, pardon me. Hello, Matthews.
Hi, Bart. Ray Anderson in Chicago.
Oh, Ray, I'd like you to handle a couple of things for me.
Sure.
I want you to find a men's shop on Jackson Street.
What's that?
Now, I don't know the name of the shop or the address, but we're looking for a clerk who sold our client a pair of pigskin gloves a little after Labor Day last year. I sent a picture of our client by airmail. You're shipping it tomorrow.
Uh-huh. Where'd you say the store was?
Jackson Street is all I know.
Bart, haven't you been reading the papers?
No, about what?
You know, all I can see out my window is snow. It's been coming down for 2 days. It must be 3 feet deep.
I wish I could say never mind.
How soon do you need it?
Well, the trial is set for day after tomorrow.
But, Bart...
I'm sorry, but I just got the information myself.
Okay. As soon as the picture comes through, I'll get started on it.
Thanks, Ray. I'll do the same for you sometime. Bye. Instead of waiting to call Ann Hobart, I went to her house.
You remember me? I'm Bart Matthews.
Yes.
Well, I'm sorry to bother you like this, but there's something more I wanted to ask you.
It's all right, Betsy.
I came back because...
Who's that, dear?
It's the man from the pet shop. I'll talk to him out here. You get some rest. Let's sit over there. I know what it is. All right, Betsy, go ahead. I'm afraid I do know Allie Kilgore.
Well, Kilgore said that he was with you that Tuesday night.
Mr. Matthews, that man's voice you heard, that was my husband.
I see.
Mr. Hobart is 67 years old, quite wealthy. He travels a lot on business. He's a collector. He likes to own things, companies, cars, boats, and wives. I'm number five. And there's not going to be any number six.
I see.
Before you get any ideas, I'm not dealing my husband off the bottom of the deck. All he wants is for me to be here, looking beautiful when he gets home, and to be good company while he's here. I'll fill my end of the bargain.
Does he know about Kilgore?
No, I haven't gotten around to telling him.
Were you with Kilgore that night?
All we do is go to a movie or dancing. Anything wrong in that?
Now, Mrs. Hobart, were you with Kilgore that night?
Oh, he's Betsy.
Oh, please, Mrs. Hobart.
Mr. Matthews, I told you once, there isn't going to be any Mrs. Hobart number six. You're crazy if you think I'm going to get into any court for Allie Kilgore.
But you could save him.
The answer is no.
He might get 20 years.
That's too bad.
Well, don't you think that if you went to your husband and...
Oh, I forgot to tell you. Mr. Hobart also collects guns.
When I went to court, I still had no defense for Kilgore. Ann Hobart, as an unfriendly witness, was of no value. And I hadn't heard from the Chicago Public Defender's Office.
Ready, Mr. Matthews?
Not quite.
Well, you still have about 15 minutes.
Would you agree to a continuance?
What for?
Well, the public defender in Chicago hasn't located the store where Kilgore bought the gloves.
You see the man sitting next to Mr. Mitchell? He's from Crenshaw's in Beverly Hills. He will testify that he sold the gloves to Mrs. Mitchell as a Christmas present for her husband.
Maybe he sold her a pair of gloves. The pair of gloves. Any word from Chicago?
Ray Anderson found that shop on Jackson Street.
Wonderful.
But the man at the store couldn't identify Kilgore as a customer. There was a fire sale right after Labor Day, and, well, there were so many customers.
Well, at least there is such a store.
The man at the store told Anderson that everything had been marked down,
because the stock had been damaged by the sprinklers. And he said that the gloves were water-stained.
He did.
Good morning, Mr. Matthews.
Good morning. Could I see the evidence in the Kilgore case?
Oh, yeah. Just got here. Here you are.
Thank you.
You satisfied now?
Well, they're not watermarked, I'll give you that.
Thanks.
Maybe Mr. Kilgore had them clean.
Say.
Oh, come now.
How about taking these across the street to the police lab? They could tell us in a minute if there's a cleaning mark inside here.
I can tell you now, there isn't.
And if there is, will you admit they're not Mitchell's gloves?
Just a minute. Mr. Mitchell, did you ever have those gloves cleaned?
Why would I? They're practically brand new.
Thank you.
Mr. Logan, it's 10 o'clock and I have
to... The judge will be a few minutes late, but you'll still be out of here by 10:30.
Thank you.
Well, can I borrow them now?
No, I can't allow the evidence to be removed from the court.
I see. Oh, Martha, would you run down to the drugstore for me?
Of course.
See if they have an infrared bulb. This should cover it.
All right.
Thanks, Martha. Now, do you mind if I use your lamp?
A thing like that work in there?
Yeah, sure.
I'll go right ahead.
One down, one to go.
You know what these things mean, Logan? That's the mark of the wholesale cleaner. That's the mark of the shop. That's the day Kilgore had them cleaned. September the 21st. Right after Labor Day. Mitchell got his for Christmas.
Bailiff, please get Kilgore from the bullpen. Put that Kilgore matter over till 2 o'clock, and I'll move to have it taken off calendar.
Yes, sir.
Hey, how come he's so downbeat?
Well, we just proved that these weren't Mitchell's gloves.
Oh, counselor, you can have all my legal action from now on.
Well, thanks a lot.
Don't brush it off, pal. You know, I can take my work elsewhere. Let that be a lesson to you.
All right, now take it easy. You're not out yet.
It's okay, Bart. I have it coming.
The bum is human.
You know, you really can thank Miss Hamilton. It was her idea to check and see if there was a cleaning mark in here.
Just like a doll. Thank you, honey.
You're very welcome.
That was quick thinking, Martha.
Wait a minute, counsel. Let's not overdo it. You know who really rates a bow? Little Allie.
For what?
For winning the case. Where are you? If I don't have these cleaned.
Attorney Logan's motion for dismissal of the charges against Allie Kilgore proved to be justified 2 weeks later. At that time, the police arrested another cat burglar and recovered the loot from the Mitchell robbery, including a pair of gloves. The case you have just seen was brought to a fair and just conclusion through the efforts of a public defender. Mike Revlon salutes public defender Joseph M. Lovely, Douglas County, Omaha, Nebraska, and his staff for outstanding achievement in the cause of justice. public defender is an attorney employed by the community and responsible for giving legal aid without cost to any person who seeks it and is financially unable to employ private counsel. It is his duty to defend those accused of crime until the issue is decided in a court of law. The first public defender's office in the United States was opened in January 1913. Over the years, other offices were opened. And today, that handful has grown to a network. A network of lawyers cooperating to protect the rights of our clients. Tonight, I'd like to tell you about a rather touching case which began in the women's visiting area of municipal prison. Mrs. Barton?
Yes.
My name's Matthews. Won't you be seated?
Thank you.
Mrs. Barton, I understand that you requested the services of the public defender at the time of your arrest this morning.
That's right. I don't have any money. Everything happened so fast that I didn't know what to do.
Most people don't at a time like this. Cigarette?
Thank you.
Care to tell me about it?
Well, I guess you could say it started about 2 months ago. My husband and I were on a picnic with our little adopted daughter. We were driving home and...
We must do this more often.
Oh, there'll be other picnics. Picnics and parties and boat rides.
You know something, Mrs. Barton? That's why I picked out a baby daughter. So I could watch her grow up doing all the things her mother did when she was a little girl.
While Fred Barton was killed instantly in the crash, his wife and daughter had miraculously escaped serious injury. When the danger of shock reaction was over, Nancy was released from County Hospital to build a new life for herself and little Kathy.
There now. My little girl's all sweet and clean and ready for a nap.
Why do I have to take a nap, Mommy?
So you'll grow up to be big and strong, like Mrs. Romano.
Oh. Are you going to make her take a nap, too?
Oh, not just now, honey. Oh, why do people always pick times like this to ring your doorbell?
I don't know.
I'll take care of Kathy. You go and see who it is. Here, go, 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 boom! Oops, here. Just a minute. Hello, Nancy. Mrs. Beam, I wasn't expecting you for... Oh... Come in, please.
Thank you.
I suppose you're here to check on Kathy.
Well, that's the nicest thing about these adoption cases, visiting all the children we've placed. But, first, may we talk for a while?
Oh, of course. Sit down.
Thank you. To begin with, I want you to know how sorry I am about your husband.
If you don't mind, Mrs. Beam, I'd rather not talk about it.
I'm afraid we must, since it concerns little Kathy's future.
But Kathy's almost mine now. The adoption will be final in less than a month.
I'll be perfectly frank, Nancy. Our investigations show your husband left very little in the way of insurance or savings.
Fred didn't make much money. We were planning on taking out more insurance, but... Well, we just never got around to it.
That's most unfortunate. Nancy, how do you intend to support the child?
Well, I was a waitress before my marriage. I thought I'd go back to that. In fact, I've been offered a job at a drive-in.
How much will you earn at the drive-in?
$30 a week. But Mr. Powers said that the tip should bring it up to 50.
I hope so, Nancy. I'd hate to see anything happen to you and Kathy after all you've been through already.
$70, $75, $2. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks.
What's the matter, kid? You look like the roof just caved in.
It has. Mr. Powers, do you have any idea how much I've earned in tips in this last week?
Oh, I figured that's your business.
Exactly $6.85. About the same as last week. That's a long way from the $20 you promised.
So I made a wrong guess. What about it?
I've just got to have another $10 a week. I can work overtime.
Sorry, kid. The other girl's got to earn a living, too. You won't get rich standing here. Domino Club, let me speak to Nick. Nick, this is Lou.
Yeah, Lou.
I've got a new recruit lined up. Yeah, brunette. About 25.
Real hungry, huh? When can I take a look at her? About a half an hour? Sure. I know where to park. Yeah.
Anything else, sir?
Yes, as a matter of fact, there is. How long have you been working here?
Why, 2 weeks. What?
And with tips, that's about $35, maybe $40 a week at most. How would you like to double that?
I don't understand.
Excuse me. I'm Nick Edwards, owner of the Domino Club downtown. You can always use a good cocktail waitress. That is, if you're interested.
Well, gee, I don't know. The money's fine, but I've never worked in a nightclub.
Serving a martini is no different than serving a malted, except the pay is better. Here. You think it over. If you decide to give it a try, give me a call tomorrow. Keep the change.
Thanks. Maybe I will.
This is Nancy Barton, the new girl I was telling you about.
Hi, honey.
And this is Sherry, our hostess. And Harry, the world's best bartender.
How do you do?
Hi, kid. Glad to have you with us.
Thanks. I'm glad to be here.
Nancy's a little green at this. I'm depending on both of you to show her the ropes, huh?
Sure thing, Nick. Suppose we get started now before the joint starts hopping.
What do you think? Nice kid, Nick. Maybe a little too nice, huh?
That's just it. No one could suspect anything coming from a kid like that.
It wasn't more than a week before Nancy found that her job involved a lot more than she had anticipated.
We've been palsy-wowsy all night. You're not gonna give me the brush off now.
But honey, I only wanted a couple more for the road. And this time they're on me.
Well, that's more like it. Hey, waitress, come here.
Yes, sir?
My friend and I are leaving. Would you ask Harry to mix up a couple of specials on me?
You're gonna buy me a drink.
You're cute.
You're cute.
What'll it be?
Sherry wants a couple specials, whatever they are. She says she'll pay for them herself.
Coming right up.
Where's your car parked?
Out in the back. Why?
Well, the boss doesn't let us date customers, so I'll grab my things, sneak out, and you meet me there in a couple of minutes, huh?
All right. I'll do that. Goodbye now.
Hold it, kid.
Helps sober him up. Won't do Sherry any harm either.
Are you sure it's all right?
Well, it's the least we can do. If he tries to drive in that condition, he's liable to get killed.
Well, since you put it that way.
What's she got?
Special of the house. Try it.
Oh.
There, feel better?
I feel great. Say, where is that dame? If she thinks she can stand me up, she's got another thing coming, believe me.
What's wrong?
All of a sudden, I feel dizzy. I can't breathe.
Down.
I gotta get out in the air. I feel... Oh.
Harry!
We better get him out of here.
I'll get an ambulance.
He's had too much to drink. He'll sleep it off.
But he was all right until I gave him that last drink.
He's had too much to drink, I tell you. Here, grab a cab, go home and forget it. We'll take care of him.
I don't want your money. I'm quitting. I never want to see this place again.
Mrs. Nancy Barton?
Yes?
You work at the Domino Club?
Well, I did, but I quit the job last night.
Afraid you'll have to come with us.
I don't understand.
We found a man in the alley near the club this morning. He'd been drugged and rolled. He claims you did.
I didn't do it. No matter what they say, I had nothing to do with it. You've got to believe me.
I believe you, Mrs. Barton. The question is, will a jury?
Then you don't think there's much chance?
All I can say is that we'll do everything that we can to see that you get a fair trial. Yes?
There's a visitor for Mrs. Barton. He says it's important.
But I don't know anybody who would...
Now, you see, you probably have more friends than you think. You'd better go see him. It'll do you good.
But you were going to ask me some questions.
Oh, they'll keep until you get back.
This way, please. You've got 10 minutes.
Mrs. Barton, won't you sit down? I'm Raymond Crandall. I've been retained as your attorney by Mr. Edwards.
But I thought after last night...
Oh, you don't think Mr. Edwards would let you down, do you?
I don't know what to think. All I know is that I want to get out of here.
That shouldn't be too difficult. I'm sure we can have bail set at
$2,500. $2,500? But I couldn't raise that much money in a million years.
There's no reason why you'd have to, if you play it smart.
What do you mean?
Whether you realize it or not, Harry was acting on his own last night when he drugged that drink. But, unfortunately, that still doesn't take Nick or the club off the hook.
What's all that got to do with me?
Just this. Inasmuch as you haven't got a previous record, if you do exactly as I say, I'm sure you'll come out better. Now, Nick will make complete restitution to Harry's victim. And in return, I'm sure we can get a suspended sentence. If you'll plead guilty to being Harry's accomplice.
Oh, the contemptible... I won't do anything of the sort. I'm innocent.
Well, just how do you hope to prove that in view of the victim's own testimony? Not to mention that of the corroborating witness who actually saw you serve the drink.
I'll leave the legal details to the public defender.
Public defender? You are naive.
At least he won't ask me to plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit.
Mrs. Barton, let me ask you this. Who pays the district attorney? The state. And who do you suppose pays the public defender? The same state. I'll you think that over, Mrs. Barton.
Well, I don't know what to do.
Of course you do, Mrs. Barton. You do exactly as I say, and you will go home with your daughter by noon. Or stick to your public defender, and hope that your child will still remember what you look like by the time you get out of state penitentiary.
Mr. Matthews?
Yes?
I have a message for you from Mrs. Barton.
Yes, what is it?
She asked me to tell you that she won't need a public defender. She's made arrangements for her own attorney.
Thank you.
Is the accused represented by counsel?
She is, Your Honor.
Do you wish to make your plea at this time?
We do. The accused pleads guilty as charged.
Due to the special circumstances of this case, as contained in this recommendation for clemency from the Office of the District Attorney, I hereby sentence the accused to a term of 90 days in the county prison. Said sentence suspended.
You thought that girl might need our help?
She still might, someday.
Crandall did a great job for Nick Edwards.
I don't get it.
Well, with the bartender on the run and the girl admitting that they pulled the job without his knowledge, Nick is in the clear.
Well, it's the DA's problem.
And ours is to guarantee everyone, innocent or guilty, full protection of the courts. And I'm not so sure she got it.
But you can't take Kathy away from me because of what happened at the club. I didn't do anything wrong. You've got to believe me.
I'm sorry, Nancy. It's out of my hands now. I have a court order to take the child with me.
I don't care what you have. I'm not going to give Kathy up. I won't.
You should have thought of that before pleading guilty to the charge.
What else could I do? They threatened to give false testimony. Oh, I know it was foolish. All I could think of was getting out of that awful place and home to Kathy.
It isn't as though you were giving Kathy up forever. There'll be a hearing. You'll have a chance to prove you're a fit mother for the child.
Sure. I'll have a chance. Like last time. With two strikes against me before I start.
I'm sorry you feel that way, but it doesn't alter the situation. For the time being, at least, Kathy must come with us.
But there must be some other way.
I'm afraid not until after the hearing. Now, will you get her ready to go, or must I?
I think I'd rather do it myself.
Kathy, how would you like...
Shh. I'm trying to make Tim take his nap.
Honey, I don't think Teddy needs a nap today. In fact, there's a nice lady outside who's come to take Teddy and you to her house for a visit. Won't that be fun?
Are you coming too, Mommy?
Not this time. But there'll be lots of other little girls there for you to play with.
I don't want to play with other little girls. I want to stay here and play with you.
Oh, Kathy. Oh, I can't.
Kathy, honey, you've got to listen to me very carefully. We're going to play a little game, honey, and you've got to promise me to be very quiet. First of all, tiptoe over to that window while I get our coats. Go on.
Please, we can wait a few minutes longer.
Out of your mind coming in here with every cop in town on the lookout for you and that kid?
Where else could I come? I need money. Enough to get both of us out of the state.
What do you expect me to do?
You owe me a week's back salary. I never did get paid.
You got sprung, didn't you? Let's just say it went for legal fees.
I'm warning you, Mr. Edwards. If I don't get that money, I'll...
You'll go to the police? Tell them you were framed? Why don't you get with it? You had your chance in court and you muffed it. Now you take the kid and get out before I call the police.
Thought we'd find you around here. I'm sorry, Mrs. Barton, but you'll have to come with us. Nancy Barton was booked on a technical charge of endangering the health and welfare of her daughter. This time, she had no hesitancy in seeking the assistance of the public defender.
Let's put it this way. You were framed for one reason, to protect Nick. Now, if we can only connect him somehow with the actual crime, it might be a different story.
Yes, but how do you do that?
Are these pills that you saw the bartender put in the drink, do you remember exactly what they look like?
Just like any ordinary bicarbonate of soda tablet, I guess. There's a dispensing machine behind the bar.
Well, then, did you see him actually take the tablets from that dispenser?
No. He was standing beside the cash register. And now that I think of it, I saw the tablets in his hand when he closed the register drawer.
Are you sure of that?
Yes, fairly sure. But what's all that got to do with it?
We'll let you know as soon as we take a look for ourselves. Call Harris at Bunko.
Kind of slumming, aren't you, Harris?
You might call it that. All right, Hogan.
Hey, what is this, a roust?
Relax, Nick. We've got a warrant. I'll ring up no sale. Are you going to do it, or am I?
Sure. I've got nothing to hide.
Take out the trays one at a time.
Now, look, what is this?
Start at the front, Nick. One at a time.
All the way out, Nick. I'll have the police lab run a check on this. You know something, Nick? You don't look so good. What you need is a good bicarbonate of soda.
All right, let's go.
As a result of the evidence uncovered at the nightclub, both Nick Edwards and Sherry Drake were sent to prison. Attorney Raymond Crandall was disbarred, and the previous misdemeanor conviction of Nancy Barton was set aside. Today, through the dedicated efforts of the Public Defender's Office, Nancy Barton and her daughter share a normal, happy life together. The case you have just seen was brought to a fair and just conclusion because of the efforts of a public defender. We congratulate Public Defender Francis T. McCurry, Cook County, Chicago, Illinois, and his staff for outstanding achievement in the cause of justice.
A public defender is an attorney employed by the community and responsible for giving legal aid without cost to any person who seeks it and is financially unable to employ private counsel. It is his duty to defend those accused of crime until the issue is decided in a court of law. The first public defender's office in the United States was opened in January 1913. Over the years, other offices were opened. And today, that handful has grown to a network. A network of lawyers cooperating to protect the rights of our clients. Last year, almost 2 million people were arrested in the United States. This is the case history of one of those people, taken from the files of a public defender in Illinois.
Operator, get me the police. The police! Quickly, please!
It's a diamond ring, and earrings, and the pin, so big. 5 diamonds.
Oh, there she is. That's the girl. She stole Anna's jewelry. Arrest her.
No! No! My daughter, she wouldn't steal anything.
Bertha Pulaski, age 18, birthplace Warsaw, Poland. Charged grand theft property. My office was assigned to defend Bertha Pulaski. My first stop, as usual, was police headquarters. Hiya, Marty. I'd like you to run a check for me.
See the chief.
Well, the name is Bertha Pulaski. I'd like to find
out... Well, at least I ain't out arresting innocent people.
What's going on, Marty?
They shut off your water.
Who shut off my water?
Know what I'd do if I was you?
See the chief. Yeah, thanks. Well, Chief.
Glad you had a safe trip back from Chicago. We can't spare any fearless champions of the innocent.
You read my Chicago speech, huh?
I sure did. At his at Gettysburg beat all hollow.
All I stated were the facts based on the records of my office. 8 out of 100 of our clients who go to trial are found not guilty.
We're pretty stupid.
I didn't say that. But you're human, you make mistakes. Can I look at some records?
You've got some records at your office. You boasted about them in Chicago.
But, Chief...
You don't seem to understand, Matthews. We're working different sides of the street. We arrest them, you defend them.
We've been friends for almost 10 years. I don't think you want to see an innocent person go to jail any more than I do.
Oh, but you're wrong. I love to send innocent people to jail. Read your Chicago speech. Send the next visitor in. Mr. Matthews is leaving.
Hi, Betty.
Good morning, Mr. Matthews.
My early frost this year.
Which innocent prisoner would you like to check on?
Hi, Bart.
Careful, George. Say hello to me, and they're liable to shut off the immigration service, too.
Betty, can I have the booking slip on Bertha Pulaski?
Pulaski girl's a client of mine, George.
We're putting a hold on her.
What for?
She entered this country 4.5 years ago. If she's found guilty on grand theft and gets more than a year, she'll be deported.
Where to?
France.
But she's not French.
That's where she entered from.
But there aren't enough jobs for the French. How's she gonna live?
Bart, I didn't make the law.
Mr. Matthews, the man who was here, he was from immigration.
Yes, I know. Now, this man, Wilmar, who says that you stole his wife's jewelry.
They'll send me back to Europe.
I understand your mother was his housekeeper.
You won't let them do it, Mr. Matthews, you won't.
Miss Pulaski, would you mind answering my question, please?
I'm sorry.
Your mother was Wilmar's housekeeper?
Since he brought us to America.
I see. And did you get along with Mr. Wilmar?
Mr. Wilmar and his wife were very nice.
Bertha, did you take that jewelry?
No, Mr. Matthews, I swear I didn't.
You don't believe me?
Well, it is rather hard to believe. A man brings you to this country, treats you well for 5 years, and then suddenly, according to you, lies and has you arrested. Doesn't make sense. Bertha, are you holding something back?
You have to tell my mother?
About what?
Why Mr. Wilmar is mad at me.
I'll try not to.
Since Mrs. Wilmar died 3 years ago, her room has been kept the same. Her clothes, hats, everything. Just the way she left it.
That's the room the jewelry was stolen from?
I didn't steal it. I went to get a book.
He found you in his wife's room.
I was by the bookcase. I didn't hear him come in. Oh, I'm sorry.
It's all right, Bertha.
I was only going to read a book. I didn't touch anything.
It's all right, Bertha. Wait a minute.
It's late.
A minute, please. You're a very pretty girl.
Thank you.
I like you. Talk to me.
It's late. My mother, she's waiting for me.
She is sleeping. Come. Sit with me by the fire.
But there is no fire, Mr. Wilmar.
It was when Anna was alive. Come, sit down. Anna wouldn't mind you sit in her chair. Tomorrow. You know what tomorrow is?
No.
Anniversary. We've been married 24 years. Anna's jewelry. I get it from the deposit box. We have the party, huh? Just you and me, Bertha. You wear the jewelry instead of Anna. All right?
Please, Mr. Wilmar.
Anna likes you. I like you.
Please, Mr. Wilmar.
Come, the anniversary kiss.
Take your time. I can wait. Okay. Why didn't you use that rear door?
It was locked. It's always locked. Even my mother doesn't have a key.
And where did you go after you left the room?
I ran out of the house. I ran down the street. There's a bench on the corner. I sat down. I was crying.
And then what?
I went home. Mr. Wilmar was there. There was a man with him. He said, that's the girl. He said I took his wife's jewelry. The man arrested me.
Why didn't you tell your story to the police?
I was afraid. Afraid they would tell my mother.
Well, I don't understand.
During the war, my mother and I first lived in Poland, then Czechoslovakia, then Italy, then France. Once a German soldier tried to touch me. My mother got a knife. She would kill Mr. Wilmar, too. Mr. Matthews, because I would not kiss him, Mr. Wilmar, can he send me back to Europe?
Where can I find this Mr. Wilmar?
Maybe home, in that dead woman's room.
This is Anna's room. The jewelry was here.
I understand you brought the Pulaskis to the United States.
I went and signed the paper.
What kind of paper?
It says I, Hans Wilmar, would bring this woman to America. It's that I would see the government did not have to give her charity to live.
I see.
In about a month, maybe 2 months, they come. Mrs. Pulaski, I like right away. She was a nice woman. Tomorrow, she could come back to work.
But you didn't like Bertha.
is difficult to say you don't like a child. In the good book, it says a good tongue is the tree of life. Bertha had a bad tongue, always making trouble, fights between Anna and me.
How?
Telling Anna lies about me. She just didn't like to see people happy.
Then you never did get along well.
I tried. As the Lord is my judge, Mr. Matthews, I tried. Like my own flesh and blood, I treated her. Anna was a wonderful woman. 24 years we married. Even Anna does not like Bertha.
Mr. Wilmar, Bertha told me about that night you found her in here.
She did? Maybe she's finding out it is better to suffer from truth than to grow rich by lies. The Book of Proverbs.
She told me that you kissed her, she slapped your face, and ran out of the room. When she returned, the police were here and you had her arrested.
Bertha told you this? Before I go to sleep, I kiss Anna goodnight. Do I need to kiss Bertha too?
What did happen that night?
It was late. I come home. In here, I hear the noise. I came through the door. Bertha was there holding Anna's jewelry. I said nothing. I thought perhaps she wanted to look at Anna's jewelry. What could it hurt?
And then?
Maybe she saw me in the mirror. Quickly, she ran out.
Well, why didn't you stop her?
Oh, I couldn't. She went out the door.
But Bertha told me that door was always locked and that nobody had a key.
Why should it always be locked? It's the door to the bedroom.
Bertha Pulaski facing deportation was a human interest story, and the local papers made the most of it. Naturally, they were sympathetic. So, a few mornings later, when I returned to the city jail...
What can't I do for you today, Mr. Matthews?
I'd like to see the crime report on Bertha Pulaski.
Just a minute. Chief, it's your friend, Mr. Matthews. He wants to see the crime report on Pulaski. Right. He says it's okay.
Thanks.
Because you're entitled to it. Here, I guess you can find it yourself.
Thanks.
Oh, he's coming right out.
Thanks again. Two questions on the crime report are, is this property insured? If so, by whom? Wilmar had told the police the jewelry was worth $5,000. I wondered how much he had insured them for. I made a note to write to the insurance company back east.
You still got time for your clients?
Why?
I figured you spent all your time at press conferences. I see by the papers we arrested another poor innocent victim last week.
If you're talking about Bertha Pulaski, I think she's going to be another one of those 8 out of 100.
You know, you won't believe this. But after reading about that poor girl last night, I cried myself to sleep.
She says she's innocent.
Then why did she refuse a polygraph test?
She refused it?
We offered her one.
I'm going over to see Miss Pulaski now. Why don't you come along?
All right, I will. And if she did it, I'll have a confession out of her before we leave. Before we go any further, how do you rate him as a lawyer? He only defends people without money. How much did Wilmar pay your mother?
$100 a month.
4.5 years, that's 54 months. That's better than $5,000. Didn't she save anything?
Mr. Wilmar took $10 a month.
For what?
To pay him back for our fare on the boat.
Well, that still left 90.
Well, he also took $60 for me.
For you?
Yes, he said it cost $15 a week for my room and board.
Well, then he actually only gave her $30 a month.
Yes.
Where did you hide that jewelry?
I didn't take it.
Then why wouldn't you take a polygraph test?
Do you know what a polygraph test is?
No.
A lie detector test.
Oh, yes. Is that what you meant?
Well, that's why she refused you. She didn't understand what you were talking about. Are you still willing to let her try one?
Yes, this afternoon.
Do you agree to take the test, Bertha?
Yes.
We'll make arrangements for this afternoon, then.
Now, you'll remember to answer yes or no to each of the questions I've already read to you.
Yes.
Ready? Remember, yes or no? Were you born in Warsaw, Poland?
Yes.
Are you 18 years old?
Yes.
Did you steal the jewelry?
No.
Is your mother in America?
Yes.
Do you know who stole the jewelry?
No.
Did you eat breakfast this morning?
Yes.
Have you told me the truth?
Yes.
Did you come here from France?
Yes.
Were you born in Poland?
Yes.
Did you steal the jewelry?
Yes. I mean, no.
Are you 18 years old?
Yes.
This tape on the polygraph machine is recording the inner feelings of the subject. Each question is answered.
Is your mother in America?
Yes.
Did you steal the jewelry?
You've asked me 10 times already.
Yes or no, please?
No, no, no!
I think that'll be enough. You can come in now.
What did you find?
Now, these are the critical questions.
About the jewelry?
Yes. She denied stealing it, and even later on when she got flustered. The graph kept a level pattern.
Then she's telling the truth.
No doubt about it.
You see, Mr. Matthews, I told you. Now can I go?
I can't release you, but this might help you.
Will you tell my mother?
About this, yes. Where is she working now?
Oh, she has a good job now. Much better than a housekeeper. She went to work as a waitress and they made her manager over the whole place. It's a big restaurant called the Blue Tiger on First Avenue.
It wasn't exactly the type of place Bertha had described. But her mother was important. She ran the donut machine. I have some good news for you.
They're letting Bertha go?
Well, not quite that good. But they did give her a test, a lie detector test, and it shows that she was telling the truth.
Then why they will not let her go?
Because that's not enough.
Two chocolate!
I went to the man at the immigration.
George Dunmore?
He says he can do nothing. If they say in court Bertha is guilty, they will send us back to France.
But not the both of you.
If they sent Bertha, could I stay here? For what?
Okay, okay, chum, break it up. On the ball, kid, on the ball. The donuts, get with it. You ain't worth a dime to me unless you're hustling these donuts, understand?
Perhaps I'd better go, Mrs. Pulaski.
Mr. Matthews, first tell me. You talked to Mr. Wilmer?
Yes.
Why is he telling lies? Bertha, she told you something? A thing I don't know? That old man, he tried to touch her?
I think I'll be going, Mrs. Pulaski.
Tell me.
Well, I can't, Mrs. Pulaski. What a client tells an attorney is like what a patient tells a doctor, a secret.
All right, Mr. Matthews. You don't tell me nothing. By myself, I'll find out.
Mrs. Pulaski.
You saw the paper?
That thing is only a machine.
It says Bertha is telling the truth.
In court, who will they believe? Me or the machine?
Mr. Wilmer, in my life I never begged. But for a child, for Bertha, I'm asking. She's a young girl, her whole life in front of her. Let her grow up here, where she's not afraid tomorrow to be running again.
What can I do?
Go to the police. You'll say you made a mistake. You didn't see Bertha. It was somebody else.
To lie is an insult to the Lord. The book of Proverbs.
Once more, I'm asking. You'll tell the police you made a mistake?
I didn't make the mistake. Now go, go out. That is Anna's.
A long nail file like this, I used in the war. You know for what?
Mrs. Pulaski, go home.
A German soldier. He tried to touch Bertha. I killed him.
You are a nice woman. Don't make trouble.
For Bertha, I could kill again.
Will that get Bertha out of jail?
You pig. So calm. So sure.
I'll kill you. I'll find a way. I'll come in the night. I'll kill you. Pig! Pig! Pig!
Come in.
It's no use, Mr. Matthew. Still, he keeps lying.
You better sit down, Mrs. Pulaski, while we ask Mr. Wilmar a few questions.
She tried to kill me. She's a crazy woman. Now you should arrest her, too.
You better sit down, too.
Mr. Wilmar, you never throw money away, do you?
Who's that waste she'll want?
I received a letter from your insurance company this afternoon. You never filed a claim for your money.
My money?
The money they owe you if that jewelry was stolen.
I forgot. And the excitement, I forgot.
The $10 every month for the boat. The money for Bertha's food. That you never forgot.
The records at your bank show you opened your deposit box March 11th.
The day before the anniversary. I told you.
You opened it the day after your anniversary, too. Why?
Is it there now? Is that where you hid the jewelry?
It is Anna's jewelry.
We can get a court order to open that box. Want to make us do that? Shall we get that court order, or do you want to tell us the whole story?
Much, Mr. Carter.
You're very welcome.
For me, too. Thank you.
That's all right.
If you'll wait outside for me, I'll take you home. I want to say thanks, too, Paul.
Oh, forget it, Bart. Sorry I got so touchy.
Don't apologize. Oh, and those 8 people out of 100 who are found not guilty when they go to trial. I never blamed the police for arresting them.
Sure sounded that way.
Well, the police work on information. Sometimes it's good, and sometimes it isn't.
Well, that's the chance we got to take. It's the only way we can operate. But I don't feel too bad. As long as the people have you and other attorneys in their corner, we'll keep on catching those 8 mistakes out of 100.
Well, I better not keep my client waiting. So long, Paul.
Oh, Bart. Water permit. It's being turned on again.
Bertha Pulaski did not bring suit against Mr. Wilmar for false arrest, although she could have, because she preferred to forget the ordeal. The case you have just seen was brought to a fair and just conclusion through the efforts of a public defender.
Did he say anything to you that night?
When the sister was taking him in, he yelled, "I know you. You own that hotel. I'll get even with you."
Mr. Berry, is the public defender putting up much of a fight?
How can he? That boy signed a confession. How can Matthews get out of that?
Well, at his press conference, he said he was going to call but two witnesses, the boy and his sister, Anthony.
Sister Anthony?
That's what he said.
We'll see about that.
Sister Anthony? Well, I taught the boys how to fish and got enough dinner for a whole table.
Sister Anthony, there's a visitor.
You should come with us next time. When the good Lord has a trout hook onto your line, there's a satisfaction. Oh, thank you.
You have a visitor, Mr. Barry.
Oh, my. Sister, you please take this to the kitchen.
He seems very angry.
Well, we'll just push up our bags and go see him.
Now listen, Sister Anthony. I came here to tell you...
Barry, won't you try one of our nice chairs?
I had poor boxes in every room of my hotel, and every nickel went to this orphanage. I never missed a year giving...
And may the good Lord have you continue to favor us.
How? I've got no hotel, no business, no nothing. Thanks to you and the way you treat these kids when they go wrong. Instead of manslaughter, they should be trying Joe McDonald for murder. He's a killer, I tell you, a born killer.
So help me God.
Joy, you heard the first witness.
Your Honor?
Does the district attorney have an objection?
I object to the public defender violating legal decorum by making a cheap appeal for the court's sympathy by addressing his client as Joey.
Denied. Proceed, Mr. Matthews.
Now, Joey, let me read this to you. I, Joe McDonald, confess that I bought 3 gallons of gasoline at Porter's Garage and used it to set fire to the Citrus Hotel. Is that your signature?
Yes, sir.
Is this confession true?
No, sir. Your Honor, I object. The defendant has admitted that the signature is genuine. No violence or force was used to obtain this confession, nor was any promise of immunity given. Prosecution holds that since the confession is genuine, defendant be enjoined from denying its validity.
Denied. Proceed, Mr. Matthews.
If this confession was untrue, why did you sign it?
Well, it was almost 4 o'clock in the morning. They kept asking me the same questions over and over again. I could hardly stay awake.
Did you know what you were signing?
Well, I just wanted to sleep, to stop all those questions. So I signed.
But it is true that you bought the gasoline.
Yes, sir.
Where did you get the money?
Well, they wouldn't let me. Let me go! You gotta let me go! Mr. Van Buren's still in there! Hey, look. Everything I have in the world. Look at it. My whole life. Look at it burn. Look at it burn. I stayed there until they carried Mr. Van Buren out.
And then what happened?
I ran away. I had to.
Why?
A man from the paper took my picture after I carried the old lady out. He knew I was from the orphanage, and I was afraid they might take me back.
Well, where did you go?
I hitched a ride to San Ysidro.
The town just this side of the Mexican border?
Mm-hmm. A lot of people from Caliente go there. That's where I found a man that used to know my father.
And did you get a job riding?
Yes, sir. I had the leg up on competitive in the fifth, and...
Don't these people have anything else to do?
It's their recreation, like us watching TV.
What's the name of Joey's horse?
Competitive.
Attention, the horses are nearing the starting gate.
80 to 1.
If we bet a dollar and Joey won, we'd get back $81.
Sister Anna.
Imagine how many new blankets $81 would buy. Wouldn't it be wonderful if Competitive did win? His horse had no closing look at all. Come on, we'll wait at the jockey's room. Hello, Joey.
Sister Anne, you can't come to a racetrack.
We received permission from the Bishop of the Diocese to come. And, Joey, come back. I failed, Sister Marie.
He was frightened.
Is that what I teach our boys, to be afraid of me?
If we hurry that next
time. We'll wait, sister.
You're not taking me back.
Joey, please come out. You don't have to run away from us.
I was in San Diego. I saw the paper from home. They're looking for me. They say I started the fire.
Did you, Joey?
No. No, sister. On my word to God. But Mr. Barry and everybody, they want to put me in jail.
They can't if you're innocent.
But they will. They're calling me a killer. They hate me. They all hate me.
Lord have mercy on their souls. They're not evil. Not even Mr. Barry. He had no insurance on the hotel. At his age, to be alone, penniless, it's done something to him.
Even you're on his side.
You're not safe here. Those people are an angry mob. They'll come after you.
They'll never find me.
They won't stop till they do. Come back now with us. We've already talked to the public defender. He'll help you.
No. No, he can't help me.
Why not?
Nobody can help me except the old woman, the one I carried out of the hotel. She knows I didn't start that fire. But she's not going to get better. It said so in the paper.
She will get better. We're saying special prayers for her.
But, sister, the paper said that she wasn't going...
In our 6 years together, you taught me about horses. Didn't I at least teach you to have faith? That bus leaves in a few minutes. There'll be another after Joey's next race. Please come back with us.
All right, sister. We'll go see that public defender. You see, it was like this. I went to Sister Anthony's office.
Sister Anthony.
Sit down.
Thank you.
You'll enjoy this. It's called The Two Little Nuns.
Well, I haven't time.
Did you lose your privilege time?
No. No, sister, I... Well, I need some new shoes.
And you'd like some money to go into town for new shoes?
Yes, sister.
They're running at Hollywood Park.
Are they?
I found this under a boy's locker.
You never said not to read it.
There's a circle around the name of a trainer at Hollywood Park. Tom Van Buren. Haven't I heard you speak about him?
Mm-hmm. He was a friend of my father's.
Joey, you're planning to run away again. Finish your vocational training here. Learn to be a mechanic. Then, if you want to become a jockey, you know I'd rather you became a good jockey than a bad mechanic. But can't it wait?
When I went into town with the truck, I saw Mr. Van Buren. He's living at the hotel.
Did he offer you a job?
Mr. Van Buren is on the Oregon Short Line.
Is that a railroad?
No, he's broke. But he's got two mares with early foot. And if he can get to Caliente, he can win a purse.
Why doesn't he?
He can't even promote gasoline money. But if I could pay for the gas, I can ride at Caliente on Saturday. Oh, please, Sister Anthony.
Absolutely no. We haven't enough money now without financing horse trainers.
Okay, Sister Anthony.
There's a truck going into town at 5:30. It'll drop you at the shoe store.
Thank you, Sister Anthony. Thank you. Before I left the orphanage, I went to the kitchen and got an empty 5-gallon can. In town, I got some gas and went to the hotel. I was looking for Mr. Van Buren's room on the second floor when it happened. Back in for Mr. Van Buren.
A public defender is an attorney employed by the community and responsible for giving legal aid without cost to any person who seeks it and is financially unable to employ private counsel. It is his duty to defend those accused of crime until the issue is decided in a court of law. The first public defender's office in the United States was opened in January 1913. Over the years, other offices were opened, and today that handful has grown to a network. A network of lawyers cooperating to protect the rights of our clients. The defendant, Joseph McDonald, age 16. The charges, arson and manslaughter. The place, El Clemente, California, a town gripped by fury.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Carl Smith speaking to you from the corridor of Superior Court, Citrus County, California. For the past few weeks, this town of 23,000 has been boiling with a violent hate. Inside the courtroom right now, the prosecution is presenting its case against one Joe McDonald. Unfortunately, Judge Lamar has cleared the court of spectators and press, but we do have a way of finding out what's going on in there. Oh, excuse me. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. George Berry, owner of the burned hotel, has just finished testifying. Mr. Berry, the angry man of El Clemente, has almost single-handed whipped this town into the frenzy which grips it now. Oh, excuse me. Excuse me, please. May I see you for just a moment, please, sir? Huh? Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mr. George Berry. Mr. Berry, we understand you've just finished testifying.
Yeah. I told him the truth about that firebug. He'll get what's coming to him. Judge Lamar was the one who decided he was to be tried instead of being turned over to the youth authority.
Well, could you tell us what you said on the witness stand?
The truth. The district attorney called me and I told him that...
Mr. Berry, did the defendant have any personal motive for setting fire to your hotel?
He hated me.
Why?
Last year, I saw him hitchhiking a ride on Highway 101. When he got in the car, I saw his sweatshirts had the letters SMO on it.
And what did those initials mean to you?
St. Michael's Orphanage. I figured he was running away. So I zigzagged around some back roads, and before the kid knew what was happening, I had him back inside the gates.